Good morning, 461. We have an anchor, 461. Let's all stand, shall we? Page 461.
Will your anchor hold in the storms of life when the clouds unfold and your wings of strife? When the storm flies in and the cables strain, will your anchor drift or could remain? We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Listen to the rock which cannot move, running firm and deep in the Savior's love.
461 on the second.
Is it safe or will the storm risk it? Or just will secured by the Savior's hand? Truth's tempest break, all God winds blow, not an angry wave shall our blood overflow. We have an anchor that keeps us so steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Passes to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love.
461 on the last.
When our eyes behold through the gathering night the city of hope, our harbor bright, which anchor fast on the heavenly shore, with the storms all past forevermore. We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love.
Thanks, weather we're having. Right?
Quack.
Yeah. Better than snow. Yeah. Right? Hear what he just said? I'm fired. I should leave immediately. Pack my things.
You want help?
Thanks. One help. You all, I love you all too. Bill Straub was just taken to the emergency room. MedPoint with Bell's palsy. He's had some real struggles, so pray for Bill. Who told you that, Amy? How did she know that? Did somebody text? Maybe Joanne text her? I don't have my phone. Joanne texts me, but pray for Bill. Pray for Bill. She's having they keep finding things in her. We haven't talked about much, but she's got issues and more surgeries in her eyes and her heart and him, so pray about that. Carol and Larry are both sick, and it's like this thing is going around. I think Carol's been sick. This is like the fourth time. Huh? And it just keeps cycling. Jeff Jeffers died. Did you see that? You know who Jeff Jeffers is, the dean of sports, Channel 16, if you watch Notre Dame football. I saw him not too long ago, and you hate to go, hey, you don't look very good. But he didn't. And, I prayed for the family. I don't know him or anything, but when anybody dies, you want them to know they're going to heaven, right? Yeah. If you live life, if you're the richest, if you're Trump, if you're Bill Gates, whoever you are, if you die and go to hell, what's the point? You know, what's the point? All this fussing about whatever, the point is, man, Christ could come back today, couldn't he? I want to do my best for him. I want to know I'm going to be with him, and I know that. I don't know I'm doing my best. I'm trying. Sometimes I think I am, and then wow. Ready? Pray. Bill Straub. Is Vicki Lowry still sick? Probably. You stay away. That's how I am. Somebody will ask me, Jim Keller. I'm not going over there. And I can call, but the jerks may come through the phone. Yes?
John.
Flogger.
John Flogger's eye. I think the retina detached again just over the last couple days.
Attached?
Detached. So now, I just got a quick text. Cherie's coming back from driving right now back from Philadelphia. But she just said last night, he's blind. He can't see right now. So pray for John Flogger. And I, you know.
Isn't that, you know, hard not to be God, isn't it? I wouldn't do that to somebody. But God has a reason, doesn't he? Like Dan. I asked Dan if he's getting better. You just, I'm going to quit praying to see if that works. It won't, right? We need to continue in prayer.
Amen.
Men ought always to pray and not to
faint.
Boy, you know what? When we don't get our answers, we want to quit, don't we? If we get answers, we want to keep praying. Enough of that preaching. Ready? Pray with me. Father, I plead now for Bill Stroud that they'll be able to help him and maybe stop this or reverse it or do whatever they can. Give whoever sees him wisdom, Lord, and encourage his heart. Help Joanne, Lord. She's not the strongest. Give her strength. I think of John Flogger, Lord. And God, you can do great and mighty things. And we want to believe that, want to live in that. Sometimes when we go through that time we don't understand, it's too easy for us to doubt and question. But you're just as much God in the valley as you are in the mountain. And may we know that, and may we pray. And God, whoever else, Carol and Larry are not well, Vicki Lauer isn't well, whoever else, there's probably others that are struggling with something. I know John Sheets mentioned this morning, he could do better. Take his pain, Lord, give him strength. And Lord, we're going to pray. We're not going to quit because you don't do what we think you ought to do. We're going to just keep praying so you help us and guide us how we should pray. And you want us to keep praying. You said we ought to not give up. We ought to, like the man at the door asking for food, he didn't say, well, he didn't answer, I'll quit. He kept knocking, and finally the answer came. So help us to pray like that. You said the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. May you help us today. Help us see things we need to see. Help us make decisions we need to make. There are needs in this room not mentioned, Lord. And you can answer. You can do so many great, mighty things. I pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated.
It's time to recognize the birthdays and anniversaries for this week. Birthdays. Rod Lowry has a birthday. Anyone else have a birthday this week? All right. When you see him, wish him a happy birthday. Anniversaries. Steve and Christy Rooley have an anniversary this week. When you see them, wish them a happy anniversary. Anyone else? Anniversary this week? All right, the next song, 455. Thy word have I hid in my heart. 455.
Thy word is a lamp to my feet, a light to my path. To guide and to save me from sin and show me the heavenly way. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee, that I might not sin, that I might not sin. Thy word have I hid in my heart forever.
Page page 9 for our course of the month. Page 9. God can do anything but fail.
God can do anything, anything, anything. God can do anything but fail. He can save, he can keep, he can cleanse any will. God can do anything but fail. He's the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Imagine that. Friday, I got a text from Doug Abel. It was their anniversary. And he said, God's timing is perfect. Kim got her test results back and everything is good. Amen. So that's an answer to prayer, right? Here, you thought God was no good. But he is, isn't he? Just, we're not God. It's hard to know what he's doing. You should have an orange sheet. I know some of you are in disbelief that we're moving on to a new chapter. Aren't you? George? George is. He doesn't believe it. He thinks I'm going to pull out another sheet that says Genesis 45. That's what it seems like. Genesis 46. But you'll notice I didn't want to go very far. And what, if you've read, I don't know if you're reading ahead or are familiar with what's here, but it basically goes into a list of who all went from Jacob's house. So the first four verses, Genesis 46. Genesis 46. When you have it, everybody have it, Genesis 46. I want you to follow if you would. You read ahead if you want. I don't care. I'm getting old. I'm just let you do whatever you want. You're rebellious children. I can't make you do what you're supposed to do. So I give up. How's that? My mom would say that. She'd pull the reverse psychology on me. One time when I played in a band, you know, I would come home literally 6th, 7th, 8th grade. I would come home 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning. She would say, what time are you going to be home, you think? And I'd say, well, we get done at, you know, midnight. She knew that. We get done at midnight and then we'll get breakfast. We'd always go out and eat breakfast. And she'd say, oh, well, why don't you just not come home? So I said, okay. Then she'd get mad. You think I'm kidding about what are you? So I wasn't a rebellious child. I was just a wicked child. Well, I probably had some rebellion in me. Genesis 46. I told this story. John wants me to tell it again, John Sheets. There was a place in Lincoln Way by the barbershop called Royal Root Beer. And they had the best Italian beef sandwiches I've ever had, ever, even to this point. And so we would finish a job playing some nightclub or some dance, and we would, they were open all night. We would go to Royal at 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning, and eat a couple of those big beef. You don't sleep real well after that, but we'd eat a couple of those big Italian beef sandwiches with green peppers all over and onions. Man, I miss that. I love Italian beef, not just because I'm half Italian. Verse 1, Genesis 46, verse 1. Hey, we got to set the stage. Some of you say, I knew it! I knew it! Jacob was under the impression for a long time that Joseph was dead. Gone. You know how you go through some of that? Some of us, all of us have gone through that. We try to accept that. So he went a long time struggling with the idea that Joseph was dead. It seems like, I don't know this,
the way I'm reading it, I went back and read it. You know, there's no key in the Hebrew language, but it seems like all that Joseph thought about, I'm sorry, all that Jacob thought about was this. He was possessed by the fact that Joseph is gone. You know people like this. You know people that can't get over something. And sometimes it's not a bad thing they can't get over. It's a good thing. And some of us who've not been through that maybe don't realize that struggle. We know, obviously, that to Jacob, he favored Joseph, right? He had the coat. That obviously bothered the other brother. So it wasn't a secret that Jacob favored Joseph. So when he thought, you know, that's what motivated when my kids were little. You've heard, and boy, they're old and I'm getting old. And it just kills me that they're old. But Mike has sent me a picture this week. Mike is my youngest boy. He's in Evansville, and he has a son, Dominic. Dominic's got bright red hair. He looks like a skyrocket. And when the kids were always little, I'd always give them the knuckle. I have big knuckles, if you haven't noticed that. So I would hold out my finger or grind them with my knuckles. And they hated it. I'd do it in their head or in their back. I love them, but I'd give them the knuckle grind. So Mike has sent me this picture of Dominic, and he's got his knuckles sticking out, and the caption said, "I showed Dominic Grandpa's secret weapon, the knuckle." And I thought, man, I wanted to show him that. You know, give him one on the side. You give him the knuckle in the side. Wah! When Micah was young, Stephen would, you know, when you look at those boys now, but when they were little, I would just beat the snot out of them just to toughen them up. And they got pretty tough. And so Stephen would always back off. Daniel's Amy. If Daniel was a woman, he'd be Amy. He acts like her, thinks like her. He's very, very forgiving. And he would back up. Micah would always come back for more. I would pummel him. Some of you women don't understand this, and you don't need to, but I would pummel him. He would be crying, and Amy would go, "Will you stop?" And Micah would come back for more. So I'd pop him again and kick him and slug him, and I didn't kill him. And Amy would go, when he would repeatedly, and he'd cry, and he'd be on the ground. And so I'd go, "Micah, quit." He'd jump up, come at me. So I'm not just going to let him do it. So, you know, I'd pop his ears or, you know, do something, give him a noogie. And Amy would look at me, and she'd go, "ATT." Not the phone company, but attention. He was doing that for attention. He didn't feel like, because he was the youngest boy, he was a little squirt, always kind of little. And I wonder if the brothers, I'm sure, there had to be jealousy about the way they thought their dad treated Joseph. So Jacob now has gotten word. Do you want to read chapter 45 again? Jacob has gotten word that Joseph is not dead. I don't know why I'm belching it. It must be my Greek yogurt. For 22 years, watch, for 22 years, Jacob convinced himself he saw the bloody coat. Right? Stay with me. He saw the bloody coat. In his mind, Joseph's gone. He'd never get him back again. But he's bothered by that. Here's what I'm going to assume. I'm going to assume that that took a toll on Jacob. See, from what I'm reading, when I get into this chapter especially, here's what it seems like. It seems like Jacob, I want to put this right. Jacob did not He was not as holy. That's not Hulk's. That's a Y. I don't believe that, and it wasn't a bad thing. He was misinformed, but based upon what he knew, Joseph was dead. So he lived that way. It bothered him. He was possessed by the loss, the absence of Joseph. And that stagnated his spiritual life. You realize the devil will use anything he can to stop you from growing. He wants you to stagnate. He doesn't want there to be a fresh flow. And I think Jacob existed, but I don't think he grew. Verse 1. And Israel, that's Jacob. And Israel took his journey with all that he had and came to Beersheba. You got maps? You got maps? Go to your maps. You got to go back. You know, the nice thing about maps is they're listed chronologically. So my first map is a 1, and I'm supposed to be real fancy and have a map that shines from a projector on a screen up here. But I can't live with that. I'm stuck at my whiteboard. I love my whiteboard. I sleep with one every night. One, let me see. No, my second map. My second map. You should have a map that shows the Great Sea, the Red Sea, Egypt, the wilderness of Paran, wilderness of Zin. And then as you look at the map, to your right should be, mine is listed, you know, Salt Sea. Did you find Beersheba? Find Beersheba. See Beersheba? Close to the Great Sea by Gaza or the Gaza Strip. Beersheba, when they left Canaan, verse 1 says they got to the border. That's what Beersheba was. Beersheba was the border of the Holy Land. So they would leave what they knew of, because the Exodus hadn't taken place yet. But when God told Abraham to leave his country and go to a land that he would show him, that was Jacob's great-grandfather. So now, as they get, verse 1, it came, and Israel took his journey with all that he had and came to Beersheba and offered sacrifices unto the God of his father Isaac. You know what would have helped Jacob get through the loss of Joseph? Offering sacrifices. Worshiping God. Putting God first. Okay, here's where Jacob is. This is my theological assumption. Jacob is very concerned. He realizes that his other boys had been tricked twice, right? Remember the money deal? Remember the silver cup deal? Jacob's maybe quoting that scripture that says, third time's the charm. You know that scripture? Right by finders, keepers, losers, weepers. And God helps those who... So the boys had been tricked. Jacob's very concerned that if he leaves, if he takes everything, and verse 1 says, he took all that he had, verse 1, and Israel took his journey with all that he had. He's leaving his comfort place. He's pulling up stakes. He's heading, listen to me, he's godly, but he's not as godly as he should be. But he's godly enough to know Egypt is heathen town, man. In Egypt, they worship bugs. They worship God. In Egypt, they worship anything that moved. Frogs. Fish. He knew that he was going to be in a bad place to be what he ought to be. He was already having a hard time being what he ought to be. His boys, obviously, were having a hard time. So at least, you know, I'll tell you what, You know why God brings some things into our life? Because it pushes us into being holy. I'm all worked up. I apologize for that. I'm not a teacher. I'm trying, but there's just something in me that I feel like I need to jump on this pew and romp and stop. So if I do that, just forgive me. Pretend. Close your eyes. Plug your ears a little bit. You'll get through it. When Jacob now gets the news, Joseph is alive. Do you think he said, oh, good? After 22 years, that would kind of sink in pretty hard, wouldn't it? What do you mean he's alive? You see him? Yeah, we saw him. Oh, really? How's he doing? Well, he looks like an Egyptian. Well, wait a minute. Now you saw him. You talked to him. So Jacob is pulling up stakes. He's leaving. He knows the promise he knows the promise God gave to him, that God would bless him, that God would make them as the sand. The Jews would multiply, the blessing would fall and spill and pour on them. They'd be like the sand of the sea. So Jacob decides, as he gets to the border, as he's just about. Man, I can remember when Amy and I left for college. I was in the last year of my tool and die apprenticeship. And back in those days, in the 70s, I made good money. I knew my father-in-law, who was in it, made good money. And I was excited about it. And I'd been through all the math. I'd been through all that junk. And I was just anxious to get this year done, get my journeyman's card, work overtime, make big money, go on with life. We were serving in church. We had a nice house. Everything was good. We were renting a house. Back in 78, we rented a huge four-bedroom house, fully furnished, $160 a month, utilities included. That's what helps when you know somebody. That was Amy's uncle's brother, and he wanted to help us out. He gave this big, nice. So we were spending money. We were blowing money. We didn't need any money. And then, boom, God stepped in and called me to preach. Said, I want you to move. You need to move. You need to leave. You need to go to school. You need to train. You need to prepare. You know what I said to God? I didn't say, I'm on my way. You know what I said? Are you sure you got the right number? You sure you got the right veto? Because there's a couple of them that I know of. I mean, not a whole lot of them. But I said, I know of another one. Maybe you meant him. Man, we leave, throw everything in a U-Haul truck. And in the blizzard of 78, head to Wisconsin, north, into the heart of the blizzard. We went through Milwaukee. You couldn't even see it. It was just white. The road, they couldn't even plow. They couldn't keep up. Literally, I'm not kidding. When we got to Watertown, the streets were closed. Cars were parked up. We got out. We stepped in snow up to our knees. I got out of the car, looked up, and said, God, I'm pretty sure you're responsible for this. Me here and all this white stuff, because I hated white stuff then. And it was colder up there, and it was snow, and I thought, this is not working. No job, no place to live. Jacob gets to the border. He's just about to leave home. He's about to leave the safe zone. And he stops. Verse 1. He stops. He offered sacrifices unto the God of his father Isaac. He wasn't even convinced of God on his own. He had to lean on the faith of his dad. That's why I don't think he took the initiative. Listen to me. If you get holy, it's not because your dad's holy. You're holy because you decide to get holy. You decide that you're going to do the right thing. You're going to read your Bible. You're going to pray. You're going to walk. I prayed this morning, dear God, there's two things I know I can do. And if you help me do those, you promise me this. The Bible says, and we know that we have what we ask of him if we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. I said, God, if you help me keep your commandments and do everything to please you, I know that that'll make you happy, and you'll bless me and answer my prayer. That two things. I can't do 10. I mean, I have trouble with one, but I can do 2. So I said, Lord, you just help me do that. Amy didn't. She wasn't there listening to my prayer going, that's right, big boy. You have to talk to God. I have to do that. Jacob did not take the initiative to be holy, but he got into a pinch. He's got all his stuff. They didn't send him a picture of Joseph. They didn't say, look, here he is with Pharaoh. Right? That would be easy, right? Send him a FaceTime. If some of you done FaceTime, Dominic's birthday, we FaceTime him. And he's wild, you know, but we could see him and talk to him live. So would it have been nice if Reuben took out his me phone and said, look, Dad, here's a picture of Pharaoh and Joseph. Wouldn't Jacob go, oh, great, I'm so good. He didn't know. He was leaving all he had, heading to a heathen land based upon the words of his crooked sons. Nobody wants sons like that. They're murderers. God obviously was tracking them down. They admit that. So Jacob goes, well, somebody sent all this stuff, wagons, donkeys loaded down. We might as well go. And then after he already traveled several days, something hit him. He gets to the border, right on the edge of Egypt, and he stops and he says, you know what, we probably really need to get God's mind on this. The wrong time to pray is when you've already headed in the direction. You pray first. You fast and pray. You beg God to move your foot. You don't get going and then go, ooh, hey, ooh. That's when a lot of people get in trouble, right? Hello? Right? So it says he offered sacrifices unto the God of his father, Isaac. Verse 2. I love this. I mean, I don't know how you read the scriptures. Here's how I read the scriptures. And God spake. You say, well, you're supposed to read it all. You're taking it out of context. I'm getting there. But what I see is it says, and God spake. Did you ever pray that? Lord, if I could just hear your voice. You know what God says? Gave you a whole book. I'm going through the book of Ezekiel. I am impressed how many times it says, thus saith the Lord, or the word of the Lord. I'm marking every time. You don't usually see that. That's unusual to me. Where it's not Ezekiel, it's God through Ezekiel. How important, how definite when God speaks. And look at verse 2. And God spake unto Israel. Who's Israel? Jacob. And God spake unto Israel in the visions of the night. Did you ever see things at night? Man, I do. Hear noises, see things. Somebody's putting a ladder up to my window. They're peeking in. They're going to get me. So you should think like that. You've got your own problems. You work on yourself. Verse 2. He said, Jacob, Jacob. Who's Jacob? Israel. Israel. I thought we were going to breeze through this. So did you, didn't you? Too much there, man. I don't try to be unique. It's just something in me. When someone says, because they hear me say, I pronounce this Israel. Some pronounce, say it Israel. I don't care. I pronounce it Israel because it's not a Z. And I'm not an English major or a phonetic frenetic. I'm not a frenetic scholar. Anyway, don't go there. Jacob, watch this now. I think this is a blank. Jacob means I before E, except after C. This is very important. When God called out to Jacob, he calls him by his old name, which means to deceive. Sometimes we act like we're not saved. Look at me. This is brainwashing. We do. We act like the old man. When I got saved, I put on the new man. And God was saying, I think, this is preaching, this isn't so much interpretation, but I think God calls him Jacob. He already just called him Israel. He was identifying what, isn't it great that God sees where we end up, rather than what we were. I mean, some of you were scoundrels. I'm not the only scoundrel in here. And God sees us where he can take us. He doesn't treat us based upon what we were. If some of us were treated based upon what we were, we'd never get a prayer answer. He calls out twice. Jacob, Jacob. Hey, deceiver. And what does Jacob say? Here am I. When God calls you, even when he calls you by your old name, you ought to answer. Jacob called out to God, did he not? He stops on the border of Egypt and the Holy Land, and he says, God, I don't know. I've got to trust you. This is all new to me. I'm taking all my stuff. I'm going into a heathen land. Verse 3. I love this. Verse 3. And he said, I am God. That's all you need. God doesn't have to tell you what he's going to do. He just has to tell you who he is. I am God. Who do you think Jacob was talking to when he offered sacrifices? God. Did Jacob know that? Not a trick question. Did Jacob know he was talking to God in verse 1 when he built an altar? Of course. He wanted God. So all that God reminds him of is, I'm the same guy. He's not a guy, no. I'm God. He said, I'm the same guy that wrestled with you a few chapters ago. You thought you could win. He said, I'm the God that changed your name. Have you ever got right with God and then don't answer out loud? I just want you to think about it. Have you ever got right with God? Like Jacob had quite a moment. I don't want to wrestle with God, but I would like to wrestle with God. Do you understand me? You know, wouldn't it be something to wrestle with God? And God changes your name and says, here's what you are, here's what you're going to be. I'm going to do this in your life. God reminds Jacob that he changed his name to Israel. I'm God. Watch me now. Have you ever went from being bad to good and back to bad again? Don't move your head. Don't raise your hand. I think that's what happened to Jacob. He's in the right place, but things happened that threw him, bumped him off course. It's hard to stay on course. Hard to stay on course. Listen to me. You could be in the right place. Huh? And get bumped. And Joseph, dead, he thought, was bumping him. Verse 3, and he said, I am God, the God of thy father. Fear not to go down into Egypt, for I will there make of thee a great nation. Remember, the promise was that God would bless not only the Jews, but the land. So now Jacob's really confused. Because Jacob leaves Canaan and heads to Egypt, where there's nothing but heathens. They worship spiders, cats, dogs, alligators, monkeys. They worship anything. So God says to him, verse 3, I am the God of thy father. Fear not. Obviously, had fear. God never tells you don't fear unless you have fear. Right? God knows. We say, you okay? Yeah. And you may be a mess. You can't pull that on God. God doesn't say to you, you okay? God pinpoints you. Don't quit fearing. So God tells Jacob, fear not. He said to go down into Egypt, for I will there make of thee a great nation. Verse 4. I will go down with thee. Was Joseph in Egypt? This isn't a hard one. Open book test. Was Joseph in Egypt? Was God with him? Boy, it sounds like Joseph's more spiritual than his dad. God tells him, verse 4, I will go down with thee into Egypt, and I will also surely bring thee up again. You're going down into Egypt. He said, don't worry. The blessing, the promise, the Abrahamic covenant that I made to the Jews will happen in Canaan. Notice what he says there, kind of different. Verse 4. Joseph shall put his hand upon thine eyes. You know what that means? When you die with your eyes open. God said, Jacob, you're going to die in Egypt. Watch. Joseph's going to be with you. He mentions Joseph. Look at verse 4. Joseph shall put his hand. This is God talking. This isn't a neighbor. This isn't a text. This is God. This is God conversing with Jacob. And he says to him, when you die, Joseph is going to be right there, and he's going to close your eyes. And you and I know that they haul his body, his bones, back to Canaan. I don't know what to do. Let me try to do some of the introduction. You ought to try this for a living. I don't get paid enough. I get like a tenth of what I'm worth. I'm just kidding. Jacob, in the first blank there, I want to make this point. The name Jacob described his old, if you will, for us. Jacob described his old nature. How many of you were sinners before you got saved? It's possible to act like that after you're saved. You know why? Because that old nature isn't eradicated. It isn't taken out of you. It's still there. So Jacob describes, this is a description of his old nature, if you will. Israel ruled by God. Wow, how would you like to be given that name? Israel describes his new nature. He's been through a lot, but not as much as Joseph has been through. Sometimes Jacob acted like Jacob. And sometimes he acted like Israel. Remember, we read that when the boys, chapter 45, they give him the news that Joseph, verse 26 of chapter 45, Joseph is yet alive. It says Jacob's heart fainted. Jacob's heart fainted. And after he saw the wagons that Joseph sent, verse 28 says, and Israel said. That's not an interpretation issue. That's God pointing out that you and I sometimes act like the old man, and sometimes we act like the new man. And when you're a Christian, you better act more like the new man than you do the old man. Let me help you with this. If you act more like the old man more than you do the new man, you probably don't have a new man. You just have willpower. I'll tell you what, I ran into a guy I went to school with, haven't seen him for years. Imagine that. It's always fun. He looked the same. He looked like he sat down for a senior picture. And it's been 40-some years ago. He's cussing, and I'm like, oh, man. You know, I don't want to tell him, you know, come on. Here's a bar of soap. Go in the bathroom. And so pretty soon he goes, hey, aren't you still pastoring that church in Lakeville? And I go, yeah, you know what? You ought to come. Oh. I'm not saying I've never acted like my old man, but that's not the majority of the time. It's a small minority. Sometimes we react like the old man. And sometimes we react like the new man. Jacob was the name. I think this is God's point. Jacob was the name of his weakness. Joseph sends, he didn't just send him a note saying, Dad, please come see me. Excuse me. He sends him all this stuff. He saw the wagons. Bring everybody. Bring your stuff. Here's all the stuff you'll need to get here. You ever read the Bible and said, hey, wow, that's God speaking to us. That's God directly. This word, when you read it, is as much God speaking as he did in verse 2. But how often do we hesitate? How often do we say, well, I'm just not sure? And of course, this is easy, right? If weakness describes his old man, then strength describes the new man, Israel. Israel. He wants to see Joseph, does he not? Man, he's missed him. My mom's birthday would have been today. I've been thinking about it. Woke up today, think she would have been 80. You know, if it was her birthday, I'd always take her something special. I'd hug her. She wasn't a real, like, loving hugger. She was kind of like, get it over with. I mean, she didn't hate me. She had a hard time with me. But I tried to love her and hug her. You know, she was very good at remembering what she wanted to remember. But thank God, when I sat down with her, she gave me a clear cut testimony that she had trusted Christ. Jimmy Baker led her to the Lord. Over the TV, you say, oh, he's a fake. But you know what is it? God's word. So Somebody said, you know, if your mom got saved by Jimmy Baker, then she's not saved. I said, Jimmy Baker didn't save her. The word that Jimmy Baker used, said, you know, so let's be careful, hey? God uses donkeys to speak to people. I know a lot of preachers that are donkeys. Hey, watch me now. I'm going to stop. No matter what you go through, no matter what happens to you, no matter what you think you deserve, no matter how hard it gets, no matter who does something to you or says something to you, no matter how bleak it looks, you have a choice. You're either going to act like the old, or you're going to act like the new. How do you think Jacob responded when he stopped? He tells them, man, they got a caravan. When you read the middle of this chapter, there's a lot of people in that parade. They all stop. I don't know if they had a lamb. I don't know if they brought one. I'm assuming maybe. But knowing Jacob's spiritual condition, I don't know that he brought one. Maybe they offered something else. But they stopped. They set up an altar. And out of respect for Jacob, they let him meet with God. They let him worship God. You know, it's when you do what God wants, it's never an inconvenience. Hello? Like, shame on you. Had to go to church. Well, then quit going. If it's that much of an inconvenience, I need it. I want to go. I'm not going to get spiritual without this place. Jacob stops and offers a sacrifice. And the next verse, verse 2, the next verse says, and God spake. What do you think that did to Jacob? You think Jacob smiled? Wouldn't he go, he's still there? You know the most miserable person? I've met a lot of happy, lost people. Let me tell you the truth. I'm not an expert. I've been doing this for long enough. You know the most miserable people I've ever met are backsliders. Man, they are just miserable. You know, if they were lost, they'd drink and wouldn't feel that bad, but they don't drink, so they're miserable. There's no artificial happiness. They're just plain living by the old man. God never promised to bless the old man. He only promised to bless the new man. So Jacob stops, gets everybody to stop, builds an altar, offers a sacrifice, and God spake. And God calls him by his old name. And Jacob said, ouch. Ouch. Right? God doesn't forget. And I call this God knows your name. And that's a play on this because God's either going to call you by your old name or your new name. And when you and I confront things that we don't like or understand or get or cause confusion or make us want to quit, then that's the time we have to just, verse 3, he said, I am the God of thy father. Fear not, I will go with you. I will go with you. What do you think Jacob said? I'm not going then. What did he say? Phew! That's good, huh? When we lived, I'll get that in a minute. When we lived, the old parsonage was right on the parking lot. The new one's down there. For any reason, if I sent one of the boys, I'd go, hey, could you run to church? It was night. Could you run to church for me? They'd go, by myself? I mean, that you got to remember, Stephen was a spindly, a little baby girl could have beat him up. He's lanky, had big feet. And I go, Steve, I call him Steve, run over to church and do this. Here's the key. You know, turn the bathroom light off. We can see the bathroom lights on. Sometimes after Wednesday, we'd look over. I go, run over. He'd go, alone? I'd go, what, you want to take Daniel, your little brother? I mean, what? He, will you go with me? I said, well, if I go, you don't need to go. Hey, it's always better when God's there. Heavenly Father, you said that you would never leave or forsake us. Help us to live like the new man and not the old man. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.